Welcome to Pharma Info with Shubhashish. So we are at the verge of completing combinatorial chemistry, right? This is found to be the final video which I am going to make, right? Or I am making, I'm still in the process, right? So now we are left with what? Solution phase combinatorial chemistry, right? Okay, we all know that, yes, there was some problem with the solid phase, right? Solid phase, because if we just try to categorize or try to, you know, classify combinatorial chemistry on the basis of the phase used and all. So there we found that one is found to be solid phase, the other one is found to be solution phase, right? So we have dealt a lot with this, we have spent so many times with the solid phase and all, but we are not done with the solution phase, right? But let me tell you one thing. Nowadays, or for the last, 7 to 8 years, this is of immense use, right? Okay. What they observe that, because of the solid support and all, it has been observed that several reactions, went in vain, right? It fails, right? And so this was the problem. At the same time, yield is an issue, right? The yield is an issue. And that is why they are just opting. Nowadays, they are frequently, using solution-based combinatorial chemistry. Because suppose key, solution-phase combinatorial chemistry. We all know that in our conventional or mundane chemistry lab, what we are running there, they are also found to be solution-phase, right? But the thing is that they are not found to be parallel one. Neither parallel one nor your mix and split method, right? So that means one pot, one bead, one pot, or one pot, one bead, one pot, one compound, right? Like this, that is parallel, right? But mix and split, multiple, compounds in a single pot, in a single vessel, multiple compounds are supposed to produce, right? Okay, that is the funda of mix and split, right? Okay, so you can expect multiple compounds in a single vessel, that is your mix and split, whereas parallel is, in a single vessel, you can expect a single compound, but if you just run it parallelly, several reactions, that you can run, and finally you can land up to several products as well, right? And that is why, with that particular context only, we can just find the similarity. Okay, similarity, because both are meant for what? Both are meant for generating, several compounds at a time. Okay, but the tarika thoda alag hai uska. Okay. Now, solution based combinatorial chemistry, right? Okay, as we know that in our mundane lab, we are making compounds. Most of the times they are of solution phase. So here also the same thing, solution phase. But what we are expecting that, in a single pot, suppose ki we have taken, 10 amines, right? 10 amines, 10 substituted amines, right? And parallelly, we are just trying to react the amines with this acid chloride. So both are of 10 in number, right? 10 in number. Now, if I just, if I wish to, introduce them, all 10, that means 20, in a single vessel, definitely, you are just making a recipe for disaster, because a petty mass will produce, right? But if I just plan in a different way, opting the concept of combinatorial chemistry, I can come up with 100 different acid amides. Right? What we can expect out of this? Amides will come, right? So, if we just opt the combinatorial concept, we can come up with 100 different acid chlorides. Assuming that, not even a single one will interact with the other one. That means, no one will interfere with others. So, that means 100 different acid amides that we can get. Right? So, in case of solution phase combinatorial chemistry, it is possible to come up with 100 acid amides while reacting 10 amines with 10 different acid chlorides. What my point? Okay, chalo. So, now let us see that in case of solution phase combinatorial chemistry, does it require any kind of support and all? The one that we found in case of solid phase. So, there we found, as the phase was found to be solid, we used the resin bits and all, okay, for the purpose of providing the support to the, n number of reagents, right, which are likely to be introduced in that particular reaction, right? So here also, whether the same thing? No, definitely not, because the term says solution. That means you are not supposed to use any kind of resin bead and all. Instead of resin bead, we can just find some intermediate things.
What is that?
That is nothing but soluble polymer. So here, as a support material, soluble polymers are used. Soluble polymers is used. Suppose ki, and the most frequent and frequently the one which is used is called PEG.
PEG, right? Polyethylene glycol. The beauty of polyethylene glycol is, on the basis of the degree of polymerization, okay, it can sometimes be in the form of a liquid, sometimes it can get transformed, it can change its physical appearance to solid as well. So that means it is the degree of polymerization that will determine the state, the physical state of PEG. Okay, and that is why this is found to be the frequent choice. Okay, we are going to select the PEG, and it is the PEG that can provide what? The active functional group. The active functional group. If we just try to figure out how it looks, actually, all are familiar with the, you know, structure of PEG, right? We are not going to write the biggest polymer. Rather, we'll just represent it in a different way, like CH2CH2O followed by CH2CH2O followed by CH2CH2OH, and here we'll just put N, as I have just considered this as polyethylene glycol, right? So here. And so here we are not supposed to use any kind of linker and all, right? The one which we use in solid phase, there we require a linker, right? Linker with active functional group, right? But here we don't require the linker. Why? Because it is the support or the phase that itself is providing what? The active functional group with which the different starting material will interact, and subsequently they can grow themselves, right? Chalo. But the problem with this PEG is either of the terminal is having or possesses hydroxyl, the same functional group, right? So both the terminals are found to be equiactive. So that means if we just protect either of the terminal by means of say for example, I just put here H5C2. So what will happen? I have just protected it. So that means this is the terminal which can accept what? The starting material. So from this end only starting material will come, right, and attach itself with this particular terminal, right, and subsequently the reaction will go on according to the plan or the design, right? So this is about your PEG and all. Okay, we have another few more, you know, support material, few more, you know, polymers. Okay, they are found to be, the another one is found to be dendrimers, right? Dendrimers. So it's a, you know, long chain and highly branched one, right? What I told, dendrimers. So dendrimers is dendrimer is found to be another, you know, polymer, soluble polymer, right? Which is also of use, right? It is a long chain, polymer, right? And highly branched one. Okay. The difference is, in case of polyethylene glycol, the active functional group was found to be hydroxyl, whereas in this case, the active functional group is found to be amino. This is the change, right? And simply you can just guess it up that it is the amino that will definitely hold the starting material and subsequent reaction will go on, right? So this is about dendrimer. We have another, you know, nice, you know, support material or the phase is there that is called fluorase phase, right? Fluorase phase, F-L-U-O-R-O-U-S, right? Fluorase phase. So here, you know, it's a long chain polymer. It's a long chain polymer comprised of CF2 moiety. So several CF2 moieties are there, okay, which are linked and which are being held by a silicon atom, right? Silicon atom, okay. And if you just try to figure out that how it looks actually, or a portion of it, if you just try to represent a portion of it, this is found to be something like this. Silicon, okay, as a tetravalent one, it can hold what? It can hold something like this. It can hold 4CF2, right? 4CF2. It's not that key, only a single silicon is there, right? Multiple silicons are there. Why? Because it's a polymer only. Fluorase phase is nothing but a liquid Teflon. It's a liquid Teflon, right? And the beauty of it is, the compound which has which will grow on this particular phase or polymer, okay, can be readily extracted with the help of any organic solvent, right? Why? Because it is the fluorase phase of the liquid Teflon that is found to be
insoluble. Insoluble in organic solvent as well as aqueous solvent. So that is why any compound which will grow, any organic compound which will grow on top of this particular support can be readily extracted with the help of an organic solvent. Okay, an intermediate can also be, you know, taken with the help of this fluorocarbon. Okay, fluorocarbon. Okay, so now this is found to be the, you know, a portion of it. Silicon being a tetravalent one can hold CF2 like this, and further another CF2 like this. So it goes on like this. CF2, CF2, CF2 like this. Okay, so this is found to be the presentation or the, you know, structural presentation or structural, you know, feature of this fluorous phase, right? This is found to be another, you know, nowadays they are also using another kind of you know, support material like your complementary DNA, right? They are also used, they are also using complementary DNA as a support material, and that is used in solution phase synthesis as well. Okay, complementary DNA. So it is basically complementary DNA. Actually, it is the small strands of complementary DNA as well as RNA. Okay, they are basically attracting what a pair of molecules, right? So a pair of molecules. Suppose these two are found to be the pair, right? Are found to be the pair. What we are expecting that A should react with B, but unfortunately, because of some reason, okay, A is unable to react with B. In that, under that particular circumstance, we are taking the help of complementary DNA. It is the complementary DNA that will just try to attach them with this particular, each of this particular fragment, right? So this is one molecule, this is another molecule, and we are dealing with this. All we want is this pair should interact with each other and develop a particular product called Y, right? But unfortunately, because of some reason, A and B will not react. So that is why we are taking the help of, because we are unable to bring them close together, and that can only be done with the help of a small strand of DNA. So it is just trying to zip it, right? And after that, the moment they are just trying to zip it, what will happen? Definitely, they have come close to each other, and as a result of it, reaction will take place. Okay, and when the reaction will take place, at the verge of the reaction, they just separate both the strands, leaving behind the product Y. This is found to be another approach with which they are just running this solution phase synthesis as well. Okay, let me just tell you that solution phase combinatorial synthesis, sometimes they are also calling it as multi-component reaction. One of the example of this solution phase combinatorial synthesis, as I told you, that multiple compounds in a single vessel, okay, can produce multiple products, right? But in a usual sense, it cannot happen, right? Because we all know that most of the reactions, they are found to be, you know, some are found to be convergent, some are found to be divergent, right? So what is the basic difference between convergent and divergent? Okay, let me just deal with this first. Here we'll just bring another concept called multi-step reaction and multi-component reaction. This is for solution phase. This is for conventional. This is found to be more diverse, more productive as well. This is found to be less diverse. I'll just come to it why. In case of multi-step reaction, we can find what? Not convergent, it's a divergent reaction. Why? Because suppose I'm just trying to react A and B. All we are expecting is what? So when they are just, there is a formation of what? Something like C. Right? Okay. Now, the moment C is formed, right, the C can generate like C prime, C double prime, C triple prime as well. Okay? So what exactly they are doing, A and B, when reacts together, so there is a formation of C, right? Why I am telling divergent? Suppose in another way, so it is the C from C, we can get C prime, C double prime, C triple prime as well. Like this, if I just write A plus B, so here we are expecting C, from C we can get like D and E. This is divergent, right? Okay. But in case of convergent, as I said that multi-component reaction, they are found to be divergent in nature. What do you mean by divergent? So divergent is, why we are getting the diversity? Suppose I'm just bringing A, I just want A, B and C, multi-components. It's not, you know, two components, three components I'm just taking, right? Because long back in the year of, 1921, I think, yes. In the year of 1921, one scientist was there, that is called, his name is Passerini, yes. His name is Passerini, right? Passerini proposed a particular multi-component reaction with three different reactants, right? So suppose ki we have brought A, B and C. So what will happen? This, this and this. There is a formation of like this, A, B and C. There is a formation of like this, B, C and A. There is a formation of like this, C, B and A, okay? So diversity, diversity. You can find the diversity, right? And they are found to be what? Convergent, not divergent. We are not expecting that C will generate like C prime and C double prime. They are producing a trimer of something like this, A, B and C. There is a form, there is also a possibility that we can end up to B, C, A. Sometimes it can also bring us, it can also, you know, give us or provide a C, B, A as well. So diversity is possible here, more diverse. I should not say that yes, through this multi-step reaction we cannot get the diversity. Yes, we can get the diversity, but here the diversity is found to be immense. Right? So this is the beauty of multi-component reaction, and which is an example of solution phase combinatorial synthesis, right? Okay. I'll just give you an example that okay, what exactly happening in case of multi-component reaction, right? Okay. We have a famous four-component UGI reaction, okay? We have with us UGI reaction. I'll just come to it first. But before that, let me just give you that it was first, invented or discovered by a scientist called, as I said a few minutes back, that Passerini, right? So Passerini was found to be the scientist, okay, who actually, you know, discovered this particular technique, that is multi-component reaction. But at that time, he used three components. Later on, the years passed by, in the year of 1959, I think, yes, in the year of 1959, a scientist called UGI, right? The UGI, he just proposed another reaction called UGI four-component reaction or four-component UGI reaction. That is also an example of solution phase synthesis. So now let us just see that what exactly Passerini did with this multi-component reaction, right? Okay. So when Passerini did that one, okay, he basically opted three different components. What are those? One is found to be acid. The other one is found to be an aldehyde. And the final one found to be R double prime NC. That means an acid, an aldehyde, and a carbylamine, right? Carbylamine, as you said, carbylamine N double bond C. So here we'll find the two electrons, right? So what can be generated out of it? Okay. If I say that the compound which will generate out of this is found to be alpha acyloxy carboxamide. This is one of the possibility. The basic funda of this multi-component reaction is you are just trying to mix them all together and just trying to, and expecting that multiple compounds will develop. Multiple compounds will develop, right? Okay. That is possible or not, let me just check. So this is found to be the primary compound that will get formed when these three components approaches each other. Three components, when they approach each other, okay. This is the primary compound that will evolve. And long back in the year of 1921, this was developed by a scientist called Passerini multi-component reaction, right? Okay. As I have written here as alpha acyloxy carboxamide. So how it goes? Like this. So carboxamide means something like this. C-O-N-H-R double prime. I'll just write alpha acyloxy to this. Alpha acyloxy, what? Alpha acyloxy carboxamide, okay? So now I'll just take this one, R, C double bond O, O, acyl, oxy, then CH, R prime. Like, whether you have got these things or not, right? So this is the one, R, C double bond O, this is coming from where? This is coming from the acid. CH we have taken from this aldehyde, and here it is RNC, in which the C
okay, which got transformed into C double bond O and finally NHR. So this is the primary compound that he got when he just threw these three components in a particular in a common reaction vessel, right? So this is called Passerini multi-component reaction, which is an example of what solution phase combinatorial synthesis, right? Solution phase combinatorial synthesis, right? So we have a drug called aginomycin, right? Aginomycin. So aginomycin is found to be the drug, okay? It's an antibacterial drug, okay? Aginomycin, okay? It is developed considering the basic organic reaction mechanism of this Passerini multi-component reaction, right? So later on, another multi-component reaction which is of use after a span of 40 years. Okay, after a span of 40 years, yes, another scientist, okay, he came up with another multi-component reaction, and that is found to be the famous four-component UGI reaction. I'll come into it. So aginomycin is developed is developed on the basis of the concept provided by Passerini, right? I'll just come to the next one, that is four-component UGI reaction. That is also an example of the solution phase combinatorial synthesis, right? Okay, let me just write it down for you. That is 4-component 4C UGI reaction, right? UGI reaction. Okay, how it goes? See, Passerini, he took what? He took acid, he took aldehyde, he took carbylamine, right? Okay, keeping this three thing as such, UGI reaction was developed but just by adding another additional reagent as amino, or amine rather, okay? So what is that actually? So that is, he started with R prime, C double bond O, OH, followed by R double prime. Let me just write R simply, R double prime. Then we have an amino here, or amine here, right? Amine here. Then followed by R double prime. Here we have taken a CH, right? CHO, that is aldehyde. And then finally, as I told that, three components are found to be same. This is found to be the additional one, right? Long back, when Passerini discovered the multi-component reaction, that time he used only three reagents, okay, essential of the primary reagents. Those are found to be acid, aldehyde and carbylamine. So here also, in case of UGI reaction also, okay, I'll just write like this, okay. In case of UGI reaction also, the famous four-component UGI reaction, the fourth component was found to be the amine here. So what the scientist is expecting here? All we are expecting is, as I told that, they are basically, the multi-component reaction are basically convergent in nature. So that means, as I just few minutes back, I showed it to you that there is a possibility of like this, A, B, C. There is a possibility of ACB, there is a possibility of BCA, and it goes on like this, right? So that means you can bring a lot of diversity, right, while dealing with this, right? Now let us check that, okay, how many components can be emerged out of this, right, following the combinatorial concept, right? So the first thing that can be, generated out of this is found to be alpha-acyl aminocarboxamide, right? So how it goes actually? So if I just write RC double bond O, then followed by R prime, then we'll just put CH R prime, R double prime, double prime, and then we have a NC here. So likewise, I'll just write C double bond O, then NH, and then like this. So this is found to be the first one. This one is nothing but, this is the amide, right? Next to this amide is found to be the alpha carbon. It is the alpha carbon that is holding what? An amine. To that amine, one acyl group is there. So that means this is nothing but alpha acyl aminocarboxamide. When Passerini discovered that particular synthesis or developed that particular synthesis, the primary compound was found to be not amino, alpha acyl carboxamide. But as UGI reaction was made
by taking an extra reagent that is amino. So that is why alpha acyl amino alpha, it is the alpha carbon that is holding what? Acyl amino. We cannot go like this amino and acyl. We have to start from the terminal, right? Like acyl amino and then carboxamide. So this is the first reagent. Okay, shall we only get this particular compound, or is there any possibility of some other compound as well? Let's check, right? If this is found to be the basic, if this is found to be the one that we are supposed to get, so that means multiple compounds we can get. If we just rub it off, this portion off, and put hydroxyl here, it has become a carboxy. That means alpha acyl amino what? Ethanoic acid. Another possibility. Okay, this can also undergo cyclization, right? Cyclization is also possible when we are just trying to react all these reagents and all. Okay, there is a possibility that you can land up to what? You can land up to benzdiazepine, 1,4-diazepine, 2,5-dione. This is another possibility. See here, R prime, all these things are here, right? Okay, this is another possibility. You can also get another heterocycle as pyrrole. So all are found to be R. You can also get monosaccharide as well. Right? So these are the possibilities. That means as it is convergent in nature, not divergent, convergent in nature, that is why a lot of diversity is there, and that is why you are getting what? Multiple components. It's the multiple component synthesis. That means at the initial level you are using multiple components, and at the verge of the completion, at the end of the reaction, you will land up to multiple compounds, and which are diversified in nature. Pyrrole is a different moiety, benzdiazepine is a different moiety, this carboxamide is a different thing, right? So that means multiple things are possible. It's not that we are just making a mess of it. It's not like that, right? And each and every compound, it is assumed that they should not interfere with others. So that is why a separate compound you can get. Separate compound and multiple compounds you can get. So this is nothing but what? Solution phase, combinatorial synthesis. So with that, we are done with solution phase. I have just shown you an example of solution phase combinatorial synthesis. And now it is, as I told you, that because of the yield as well as the reaction, that means accidental failure. I should not say accidental, or more failure in the reactions and all. So that is why solid phase are found to be less used than that of solution phase. Okay. Yield is an issue. At the same time, most of the reactions, I should not say most of the reactions, few reactions are there which often went in vain. So that is why they are just opting what? Solution phase. Why? Because the productivity and diversity is found to be more in this case. So that is why solution phase nowadays, it is an era of solution phase, not the solid phase, right? So thank you very much. Thank you for your kind patience. If you like this video, don't forget to press the like button. And put your valuable comments in the comment box. It's very, very much essential, and it should be unbiased, right? There should not be any biasness and all. Please feel free to write all these things, but don't use a lot of jargons and all, right? You should be more precise and all. Okay, just you just get me some feedback and all, so that I can grow, right? So thank you very much. Thank you once again.